Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name is Tan Tan. I'm a multimedia editorial writer with the Seattle Times editorial board. I appreciate you all joining us. We'll be talking for the next half hour or so about the topic of sex trafficking here in Seattle. And the reason why we're having today's chat is because there's been a number of developments this week, but chiefly we have filmmaker Tim Matsui here with us. And this week he is showing his documentary, The Long Night, for free. Streaming video. We'll be talking more about that and getting reaction from other panelists, but I'd like to introduce everyone who's joining us here today. We have, from left to right, we have Mar Brettman with Businesses Ending Slavery and Trafficking. Mar, can you wave to everyone? Okay, thank you. We have Noel Gomez, who is a prostitution survivor and co-founder of the Organization for Prostitution Survivors. We also have Robert Beiser, who is the founder and executive director of Seattle Against Slavery.
Good afternoon.
And you'll notice at the bottom of the screen, that's just, you'll kind of see my photo. It's not moving or anything. Caitlin Moran and Nico Lasbo are producers here at the Seattle Times, and they're helping me behind the scenes to get this thing going. And we also have Tim Matsui, who's a filmmaker and journalist here in Seattle. And we also have Val Ritchie, who is a senior deputy prosecutor with King County, who tries many cases involving child sex trafficking victims. So first of all, let's go to Tim and have Tim tell us a little bit about why you wanted to make this film available, streaming for free, where people can watch it. Tell us the motivation for this.
Well, ultimately, I want the film to be seen by as many people as possible. It's a broad audience outreach tool to build awareness and to engage people emotionally. We tried the theatrical, we tried the broadcast, and I think that it's dark, it's emotional and challenging, and documentary, and indie docs, you know, sometimes they struggle to get traction, and, you know, I thought back to what is the real purpose of it, and that's to make people aware and to engage them, so why not put it out there and use grassroots marketing campaign and really go through communities and have people speak for it and share it that way. You know, it's kind of building a movement is the way I look at it.
Tim, it's a really powerful film, but it's really hard to watch as well. I mean, you follow two teenage girls. One of them is addicted to heroin. She's still out there, working today, as far as I understand. And how did you tell me what was going through your mind as you were building trust with these characters? Like how with these girls and how it is that they allowed you to see a side of their lives that is so, you know, difficult for people to watch.
I guess the only thing I could do is, you know, be transparent about what my intentions are, which is to tell this story. And, you know, in the case of Natalie and her family, they wanted to share their experience. As Natalie says, if this helps one girl, like she doesn't want somebody else to have the same experience. And I think with Lisa, who's the young woman who's still on the street, I believe that she really wanted people to see her trying to get out of the life. She was turned out at 13, and she picked up heroin along the way. And breaking addiction like that is incredibly, incredibly difficult. And so, every chance, every time she tried, I feel that needs to be recognized. And, I guess that's how I presented it, and they chose to be a part of it.
And can I get some reaction from others on the panel? I'm not sure if every single one of you has seen the film, but go ahead and just jump in and let me know what your thoughts are and what you're hoping that the audience will take away from seeing this.
Sure, Tom, this is Val. I thought the film, like you said, was incredibly powerful. It also, I think, as you said, was hard to watch. And the reason for that is because the world of prostitution and sex trafficking is not pretty. And I think one of the really important things that this film does is dispel the misleading notion that prostitution is really just a victimless crime between two consenting adults. I think when you watch the world of Natalie and you watch the world of Lisa, you come to understand how grim this existence can be and how important it is that we have comprehensive, meaningful services for people in the life. And I think those services are what can help somebody get out of that life and go on to do other things. And somebody who can probably speak to that better than anyone is Noel.
Oh, thanks, Val. Yeah, I did watch the film,
and it was really good. So good job, Tim. I think that, yeah, with Lisa, you know, in showing how much she was trying to get out of the life and how she didn't want to be in the life and she didn't want to be doing what she was doing. And, you know, I don't think people quite understand what a struggle it is to try to get out of that once you're so deeply entrenched in it, you know, and that really shows her struggle. And, you know, from my experience, that's the struggle that hundreds and hundreds of women and girls are having, you know, on the streets of Seattle every night, every day, 24/7, doesn't stop on holidays, you know, all the time. And, you know, so I think that that is important for people to see and to understand that it is not a choice for a lot of these women and girls. It's just not, it's not a choice, and they don't want to be there. And, you know, with Natalie, you know, that the story with her pimp turning her out at a young age, and that is just, you know, the kind of traditional, typical story. That's what happened to me. That's what happened to her and a lot of the other women and girls that I meet. And then they grow up and they become adults. You know, and there's the traumas never dealt with, and nothing's ever dealt with, and they end up out on the streets. And that's another thing that people don't think about. In Natalie's situation, she's very lucky because she has a family. Most of the girls and women out here don't. So, yeah, I think it's important for people to understand that.
Hey, Mar, I'm curious about your perspective. A lot of the scenes in this film take place, not a lot, but several of the scenes take place in a motel, which, as I understand it, is now closed now, right, Tim? Has been busted?
Yeah, it was shut down along with two others, but I think I heard that they reopened it with new owners.
Okay. Well, I'm curious for Mar's perspective in terms of the business side of this and the work that you're doing, you know, in helping businesses to end sex trafficking and getting your perspective.
Yeah, I thought Tim did a great job in the film. He's obviously a very gifted artist, and I really loved the way that he helps the audience understand trafficking by really showing us one key narrative, and, you know, getting us to understand how it impacts one family, and then also some other people around that. But I thought he did a tremendous job. He, you know, his portrayal of motels was accurate in the way that many of the aspects of his film were just very accurate. Hotels are the places where this crime happens. We did a study in King County to look at where sex trafficking crimes were taking place according to those crimes that have been prosecuted. And we found that 63% of the crimes involved hotels and motels, and those range anywhere from the kind of no-tell motel that I think was featured in the film, up to four-star luxury hotels in the heart of downtown Seattle and Bellevue. So it really does take place across the board throughout the hotel industry, and it's really a risk for the hoteliers to not be aware of what's happening and to not know how to stop it from happening.
Robert?
Thanks so much. I think one of the things that was really great about the film is that it was a very personal representation of trafficking. I think in the work that we do with Seattle Against Slavery, we work on a broad set of trafficking issues, from labor trafficking to sex trafficking, adults and children. And a lot of times when we're doing outreach and education, people start thinking about human trafficking as something that happens very far away, maybe something that happens in foreign countries or something that happens to people not in their own community. And I think one of the things that was really positive in the film was that it puts a personal face on the fact that these folks, you know, we used to say underage prostitutes or juvenile prostitutes, but it's human trafficking victims. That's the legal definition. And when you see the violence that is going on, you know, the hardship and the trauma, as Noel expressed, you can understand why this is a crime. why, you know, folks like Val are working so hard to keep the men who are buying sex from these underage girls accountable, to keep the pimps who are involved in, you know, facilitating this crime accountable. It's a really horrible thing. So I would say, you know, in looking at this film, probably one of the biggest takeaway messages for people who are seeing it is that this is something that's happening in our own community. I think one of the next steps then is thinking about all the other ways that probably weren't presented in the film, you know, folks from immigrant and refugee backgrounds, you know, folks who are people of color and youth of color who are disproportionately impacted, always trans youth, that there are all of those elements going on in trafficking right here in Seattle as well, and that this is a great way to start the conversation and wake people up to the fact that it could be something that's happening in their own community.
Can you all talk about the scope of the problem? A 2008 study that was commissioned by the City of Seattle, that was done by Dr. Deborah Boyer, she concluded an estimate that, you know, like 300 to 500 kids, minors under the age of 18, are trafficked each day. But apparently that is a conservative figure, a low number. Val, can you touch on that? What is the scope of the problem and why?
Well, the difficulty is that we don't really know the scope of the problem for juveniles engaged in prostitution. We know it's big, and it's a lot bigger than obviously is acceptable. The other problem, of course, is that it's not just juveniles, but it's adults as well who are being coerced and forced into prostitution. And so that's a problem that we don't have any grip on the numbers. The much greater problem, however, is that there is a massive demand market that is causing all of this. And we've done some research with Arizona State University and some other entities to try to assess what the volume of demand is in our region. And the estimates that we've come up with this fall is that there are as many as 27,000 buyers online soliciting sex. Now, when you have that type of volume of demand, the end result is going to be exploitation. There's just no way around it, because there are not anywhere close to the number of people who would be we might consider voluntarily engaging in this to meet that demand. And the result is that pimps exploit juveniles, they exploit adults because they can make money. And so on the one hand, you have a tremendous number of people who are being exploited, and then on the other, you have a tremendous number of men who are creating the demand, which results in that exploitation.
Hey, Tim, can you talk about some of the Johns? Because in the film, you go along with the cops and the sheriff's deputies on some of these busts. And what did you find in encountering these buyers?
What I found is that they're all ethnicities, all social classes, all economic classes. Some fessed up, owned up to what they were doing. Some didn't think that much about it, and others were confrontational. You know, it's proven. It's the guy next door. You know, it's everybody. Demand is across the board. It's kind of crazy in that respect, I think.
Noel, you're nodding your head.
Yeah, it is kind of crazy, Tim. the demand, and just across the board, it's just every different kind of man and profession and ethnicity and that you can imagine.
Well, and what, just to add to that, one of the things that I think is so interesting is that demand can change depending on the medium. What we found is the men online soliciting sex tend to be more middle and upper class and tend to be whiter, which I think cuts against the popular perception about who's buying sex. It is really the educated, the well-to-do, the whiter men in our community who are driving demand online, at least. So I think it's important to set aside any perceptions that we have about what we think, who we think the sex buyer is, and start to look at the data for who they actually are.
Yeah, and actually when you talk about... Okay. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I would just say another important part to look at in this, Tim did an incredible job in the film presenting the violence and the experience of these women and girls who were being prostituted and how horrible that was. And yet, in our society, you know, for men, we sort of accept this practice going on, even knowing how violent it is and how, you know, traumatic it can be, you know, the things that it leads to, people coping with it through drug use, through alcohol use, just to deal with that experience. And yet, you don't hear a big public outcry about the need for men to not buy sex, even for men who aren't engaging in of themselves. You know, some of the research has shown that we as a society are sort of approving of, you know, men for bachelor parties or men for their 21st birthday getting involved in this practice that we know is so violent, that we know causes so much suffering, especially to women and children and sometimes men. And I think, you know, a good next step for all of the men who would see this film is to have really honest conversations with the other men in their lives saying, you know, I wouldn't say it's okay for you to be involved in domestic violence. I wouldn't say it's okay for you, you know, to be involved in hurting someone else. You shouldn't be involved in buying sex because it's a combination of those things.
One of the things that I'm finding as I'm talking about this stuff, it really kind of goes back to the work I did about a decade ago on sexual violence and about shifting social norms. And there's a line that the spoken word poet had, which was, I don't know, actually yesterday I was at a presentation and one of the men in the room said, you know, I'm so glad I don't have daughters. And to me that's a very fear-focused, fear-based way of you know, addressing the issue. And that spoken word poet, she had a line which was, it's not what we're going to tell our daughters, it's what we're going to teach our sons. And I really think that, you know, we need to get this stuff into younger audiences and help shape the perceptions and those norms about, you know, what is gender equity and relationship and, you know, to go back to sexual violence terms, you know, what is consent and how to respect somebody else. That's kind of where I would like to drive this.
So I've got a question here from, I've got a couple questions from readers that they sent in to us before this chat started, and I'm just going to pose this, and whoever wants to respond, go ahead. But Brian Ingy from Seattle, here's his question. Are there reasons that certain neighborhoods are targeted for prostitution? What can we as neighbors do to stop this from happening?
Well, I think there's a lot of areas of our city where street prostitution has occurred and has been well known to occur in great volume. And I think if you're looking for an opportunity to get involved, there are a lot of ways you can volunteer with organizations to help out. One of the best ways to help curb street prostitution is by offering services to those who need it. Another great way is to make that a really inhospitable place to come and buy sex. And so we are looking, that's why we're targeting guys who are going to those places to buy sex. But the thing that we want to not forget about, too, is that the online market is where the explosion is really happening. And so we might not see it as much on the street as we used to, but that doesn't mean it's not happening. In fact, it's happening in a tremendous way online. A recent study by the Urban Institute found that the commercial sex industry in Seattle doubled in size between 2003 and 2007. That's an alarming increase. And we are one of the fastest growing industries in the country. So although we may not see it as much as we used to online or on the street, that's because it's online and there's plenty of opportunity to intervene there as well.
Anybody else want to chime in? Okay. Here's another question, and this one's from Suzanne Winston of Seattle. She asks, what regime of legalization and regulation of prostitution would best protect sex workers and the public?
So I can step in on that one. I think that the problem with the argument for legalization is that people are looking for a solution that will reduce harm to those that are in the life, and will try to help them not suffer violence. The problem is that legalization has consistently been shown not to work. What happens in a legalization system is that more men buy sex, and when more men buy sex, That increases sex trafficking. That increases child prostitution. That results in more exploitation. So in systems like the Netherlands or in Germany where they have tried legalization, or in Nevada where they've tried legalization, the result has actually been an increase in all of those things that we are trying not to have more of, like harm against women and children. A much more effective model, and this is, I think, goes to the question that was posed, a much more effective model has been shown to be the Nordic model in Sweden and has now been adopted in Norway, Iceland, and a similar model in Canada. That model is to focus on offering services and not prosecuting the people who are in prostitution, those who are being prostituted, to not prosecute them, to not criminalize them, to not stigmatize them with putting them in jail and giving them a conviction. On the other hand, that system or that model also focuses on prosecuting and holding the buyers accountable for the demand for sex that they create. That system has been shown to dramatically reduce the occurrence of sex trafficking in those countries where it's been used, and is probably the most effective model that has been designed for dealing with this issue.
Does anybody else want to weigh in on the Nordic model? I'm curious, would that have to be something, is that something that could be implemented at a local level, statewide level, or is that a federal?
Well, I mean, to a certain degree, law enforcement and prosecutors in King County are already implementing this in a very unofficial way. And what I mean by that is using our discretion to figure out ways to get these women and children into services rather than booking them into jail and charging them with the crime. We have the discretion to do that in certain circumstances, and we are doing that to the extent that we can and to the extent that services exist. We are also aggressively going after buyers. So in some sense, this is a kind of ad hoc Nordic model that is being tried here in King County to see if we can get a grip on the problem. And I think that the response from the community, from the groups who work with survivors, from the groups who are interested in curbing sex trafficking, the response has been extremely positive to this approach.
Noel, can you talk about the services that are needed to help young women and men who want to leave the life? When we talk about services, what does that mean?
Well, services, we mean like advocacy, mentorship, case management, help with doing things that need to be done to move forward into the next step, support groups, counseling, everything that a woman needs that's coming out of the life. And I want to kind of go back to that the legalization thing that we were just talking about. As far as the end of survivor aspect, I also think the Nordic model is the best option, and I know that there are certain privileged sex workers who believe that legalizing prostitution, and there's a lot of men who respond to these types of things saying, why not just legalize it? I think what those women and those men are not understanding is that we would have a complete mess if we did that. There would be girls being trafficked from all over the world to come here to get some American money. And so in that case, it would turn into a complete mess. The prices would be completely different. These women who are fighting against, us, who we don't want to legalize it, they're fighting against us because they want to legalize it, aren't thinking about how that would change things for them as well. It wouldn't be a good scene. And so I think the Nordic model is the best, and for that we need resources. We need more advocacy, we need more case management, we need more people on the ground working with these women. We need more direct service workers, so we need more money to support more workers to work with these women and girls to help them change their lives and begin to look at themselves differently and maybe get some self-esteem and start believing they can do something different. And that's what it takes. And so we need those resources for these women that we want to refer. So, you know, it's going to take, if we're going to refer women, we got to have the resources to do it. And we do have some resources, but we do need more than what we have now.
Mm-hmm. I would also add that I think it's really important in this conversation to acknowledge all the services that are being provided currently. There's a network called the Washington Anti-Trafficking Response Network that works with both foreign national survivors of trafficking and folks born and raised right here in the United States. That's organizations like International Rescue Committee, Youth Care, API Chaya, Northwest Justice Project. These are organizations, along with groups like Organization for Prostitution Survivors, who are doing this work day in and day out, working with these survivors, meeting them where they're at, and taking care of their needs as the survivors say they want their needs taken care of. So, you know, it wasn't something that in a film you can't explain everything about the scene around an issue as large as trafficking, but there are a lot of organizations out there that if people want to support them, you know, giving these survivors the best opportunities and the best set of resources they can have so they can make the choice to leave these situations, that's a great start. And so I'd encourage people, if they want to volunteer or donate with those organizations, that would be a great thing to do.
Mar, how can we get businesses more involved in this effort to fight trafficking?
Good question. So far, a lot of the response has been focused on law enforcement and services, which is incredibly important. And we brought together a group of stakeholders who are thinking through where how to actually prevent the crime from happening in the first place. So one thing we have talked about is demand. So if we can reduce demand, then we can reduce the crime. And so one way that we want to start working with businesses in the future is to start educating them around the risks that sex buyers who are employed by their company actually pose to their company. So we'd love to get businesses involved in demand reduction efforts in our area. Another thing is that businesses often unknowingly fund and facilitate the crime. So the perfect example is the one that you brought up earlier of hotels and motels. And so we started working with the Washington Lodging Association a few years ago, and they, you know, members from their association were very, very supportive of bringing training to members throughout the state. So we were able to, we worked with Val and Noel and others to create best practices for hotels, and then we did a training in King County, was our first training, and we thought, okay, hopefully we'll get 80 people at this training from the hotel industry, and we ended up with over 100. So this said to us that the hoteliers in our community are incredibly compassionate people. We kept hearing from them, you know, I have a 14-year-old daughter. I would never want this to happen on my watch in my hotel. And so we've been able to, just by educating them and raising awareness about this crime and about the way it impacts the community, they have been willing to be on the front lines of fighting it, working with law enforcement. So we've trained over 500 people throughout the state in about 6 counties that we've been working in. And so I think we can all be encouraged, you know, that the film can be kind of grim, because it really does show the reality of what happens, but there's also a lot of encouragement of all the work being done, not only by service providers, law enforcement, but also businesses in our community that are taking wonderful action to prevent it.
You know, just to circle back to something Tim said earlier from Mar's comments, the actions that BEST and that Mar is trying to do working with businesses is exactly that type of norm change that Tim was just talking about earlier. That's, you know, helping the community to understand this issue and to start to change its mindset towards the issue. That's the kind of thing that Tim was talking about earlier that can really alter the incidence and the occurrence of sex trafficking and exploitation in this area. And I really applaud Mar's efforts in that area, because it's the business community that can really help to influence how the community at large views it.
Thank you. And, you know, one person who was supposed to participate in today's chat, but she's very ill, is State Senator Jeannie Cole Wells, who has been a leader in the legislature in terms of passing bills that have made, you know, trafficking a felony crime and all sorts of other things to try to fight this problem. And so she, unfortunately, she couldn't be here. But from a public policy perspective, Washington State is tends to be viewed as being way ahead of the game. And can you all talk about that? I mean, you know, how much further do we have to go policy-wise? Like, if you could talk to the legislature today and tell them to pass, you know, one thing or to work on one issue, you know, what would that be?
Well, I don't know if I want to if I want to start telling the legislature what to do, but what I will say is that the legislature has been phenomenal in terms of establishing serious penalties for sex trafficking related offenses. They have given law enforcement and the prosecutors great tools for responding to this issue. I think beyond that, the mere act of creating these crimes and of showing how serious they are tells the community at large how important this issue is and how important it is to respond seriously to it, which I think goes beyond just the law enforcement response and goes again to that issue of setting sending the message to the community that this is serious and that we're taking it seriously. Anything that we can do to further that, I think, is a step in the right direction.
To echo what Val said, and then Robert, it looks like you want to speak as well. So I agree that our legislature has been just wonderful. One thing I would love to see is that our legislate, you know, our government, our state government, our county governments are some of the largest employers in the state. And so I would love to see the county and the state and the, you know, any of the local level be willing to adopt policies that say we don't, you know, allow our employees to buy sex. If there is, we have a very clear disciplinary process for employees who are caught buying sex. So this would, again, create that sort of norm, that would be a norm-setting value that employees could receive. This is not okay. This is not an okay practice. This is harmful to women and children in the community.
I would just add to that, you know, Seattle Against Slavery has worked with Senator Cole Wells on a number of the bills since 2009 when we came into existence, and she's been working on them since 2002. And there's a number of criminal statutes in place, and there are penalties and there are fines, but like Mar said, this is going to take some leadership on changing norms, starting with the state itself. So every time that money comes up for public awareness and we address the issue of hand washing instead of addressing the issue of sex trafficking, that's making a statement about our priorities. Every time that, you know, we're doing training for law enforcement and we're training them on, you know, crowd control instead of how to work with a potential victim of trafficking or survivor of trafficking, that's a choice that sets some norms. I think if we were doing more on the state level, you know, so that nonprofits didn't have to be educating all of the businesses in all of the cities, you know, that would be a huge thing that we could do that would, again, prevent this issue. You know, no one wants for there to be lots of trafficking victims and then lots of services to serve them. I think everyone wants people to not have to go through this in the first place. And I would say for everyone who's, you know, tuned in, when Mar talks about businesses engaging this isn't waiting for some big corporation somewhere to take this on. If you work someplace, this is the type of policy you can take on at your business. People can get involved. And for, you know, the legislature, we have great leaders. You know, Senator Cole Wells is one of many. You know, Tina Orwell is another one who are taking this issue on. And we can move forward with putting stakes in the ground, saying that we don't want this to happen to people in the first place, so that we don't need the crime, you know, laws in place, we don't need the prosecution, and we can have people not have to suffer and not have to deal with the repercussions of this through their lives.
Robert, I really like your individual call to action. I think that's important for people to take responsibility, and, you know, I think about this whole bystander society that we have, in which, you know, it's that issue over there and it doesn't affect me directly, so I'm just not going to pay attention to it. And so I really do like that call to action that you have. One thing I would like to see, actually, there are two things. But one is looking at the root causes. I think that trafficking for labor or for sex really is just a symptom of underlying issues. You know, in some cases there's demand for sex or demand for cheap products or cheap labor or inexpensive food. And that can affect, you know, it creates a market, basically. And you know, if we then don't look at things like healthcare and education and, you know, sexual violence at home and abuse or lack of economic opportunity, those things create vulnerability. And then it just feeds into that demand that we have for those cheap products. So I would like to see people, again, going back to that individual responsibility. If you're moved by the stories about trafficking, then look at what your level of influence is within your sphere and see how it relates to a root cause that might create vulnerability. The other thing I really kind of want to address is, you know, because we don't have a patrol officer here in this conversation, and Lisa's out there somewhere, you know, I really got to... They tried, and they made something. The deputies in SeaTac who did this and created the drop-in center. And the reason that they did that is because when you're out there at night and you are three patrol officers on duty and you get a domestic violence call and two of your officers go to deal with that, you're one person left to handle 911. And when you come across somebody who's, you know, involved in prostitution, you don't have the time. And to be able to hand them off to a drop-in center that's nearby to give them the opportunity to seek services is huge. So it would be really nice to see, I guess going to what you're saying, Noel, is to have additional funding and training to develop more drop-in centers that allow patrol to divert people from jail to get them into a place where they can have resources available to them readily. I look at Lisa with her issues around addiction, and I can't help but think of some of the harm reduction models that are being practiced elsewhere. I mean, even just across the border in Vancouver. She is an addict, flat out an addict, and she uses it to be able to exist, to avoid her reality. And, you know, she does not need incarceration. She will say she needs incarceration because that will allow her to detox. But in jail, she doesn't get services that once she's released will keep her from relapsing. And the pull is just too strong, and she needs far more care than currently exists, I think. So you know, there's the Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion Program here, started in Seattle, first in the nation. I think something like that could be expanded. You know? And I think that, honestly, I would love for Lisa to be put in touch with the outreach workers that work with the LEAD program. Because I really want to support her struggle to get out of the life.
And Noel, Tim, regarding services in the area, I did just want to also mention that there's the advocacy line that's run out of the King County Commercial Sexual Exploitation of Children Task Force, which does provide a network of advocates to come around a child if they're identified. And then also, you know, as you also mentioned, the Organization for Prostitution Survivors is a great place for people if they're in need of help to be able to reach out to OPS. I think their address or web address is seattleops.org.
I will add that to both thelongnight.com and leavingthelife.com. It's in the resources. Thank you for reminding me.
And Noel, you talk to girls, women, every day of the week who are still in the life, who have left the life, who are trying to leave. It's really difficult sometimes for us to put a face on the sex trafficking issue. Can you just leave us with some thoughts on what you're hearing from the people that you're encountering who are still out there on the streets and what they need?
Yes.
It's like, I mean, you talk about services, but, you know, I mean...
Yes. No. I would love to talk about what's going on out there. What you see in Tim's movie is very real. It is happening all the time. I work with girls 14, 15, 16 years old, 17, 18, all the way up to 50 years old. Okay, there are hundreds of Lisas out there. I mean, there are hundreds that I have met over the years. There are hundreds and hundreds of youth who are being exploited over the internet, mostly. And, you know, these women and these girls, who they want help. They are asking for help. We wouldn't be out here trying to help people if they didn't want help. I mean, these people want help. You know, they want support groups. They want an advocate. They want somewhere to feel like they're at home. They want somewhere to, you know, be able to go talk to somebody who, you know, another survivor who has gotten out of the life, or somebody like that, a mentor, somebody who can give them hope. These women want help. These girls want help. They don't want to be where they are. And, you know, yeah, more drop-in centers, more, you know, long-term support for these women. Because, yeah, if they go to jail or they go to detox, there's still not the services when they get out to keep them from going back to the life. You know, we need long-term advocacy and mentorship for these women and girls. And that's what we're trying to do at OPS, is to offer that for these women and girls. Because once I'm your advocate, that means I'm your advocate until forever. So, you know, that's what we're doing. And that's what needs to happen, is that these women and girls need a consistent person in their life that is going to be them there for them, whether they're in the life, trying to get out of the life, or where they're at. You know, because, you know, I've had girls that I worked with when they were 15 years old, and I'm working with them now, and they're over 18 years old, and they're reaching out for help, and they still call, you know, because at some point they're going to be ready and they're going to leave, you know. And if we're not there consistently for them over the years, then where do they go? You know, where do they go? There was no help for me when I was getting out, and that's why we started this organization, so that we could offer help. And there is so much need. I mean, you know, it's overwhelming, the amount of need, really.
Thank you so much for your perspective. And I think we're going to go ahead and sign off in a minute, but first, Tim, tell our viewers how they can still watch the film and for how long.
Thank you. Yeah, the film is available for free on thelongnightmovie.com, and you can join in conversation at facebook.com/movie the long night. It's also available at mediastorm.com and thealexiafoundation.org. The Alexia Foundation was the seed capital, the Women's Initiative grant that allowed me to do this work.
Thank you so much. And Bretman, Noel Gomez, Robert Beiser, Tim Matsui, and Val Ritchie. And also I'd like to thank Nico Lasbo and Caitlin Moran, who are off camera but helping with production behind the scenes. Thank you all for participating in today's Hangout. This video will be recorded and made available on our blog, the Opinion Team's blog. Just go to seattletimes.com and go to the Editorial and Opinion section. My name is Tan Tan, and thanks again for watching.
Thank you.